differentiation. So if you multiply the time domain sequence x of n with simply n, the time index, then the consequence in the Z transform domain will be what? You have to take the derivative of Z transform and multiply it with minus Z. ROC will not be changed. ROC is unchanged, so that is a very simple thing. You just have to take the derivative. So if we take an example of this property also, let's say we are given x of z, let me write the property name here, the differentiation, x of z as log of 1 plus a z inverse, and the ROC as z magnitude greater than a magnitude. So what will happen here? We have to take the inverse Z transform. That is the problem. So x of n needs to be found. X of n needs to be found. So now there is no Z transform pair through which we can take inverse Z transform of logarithm. So due to this reason, if we take derivative of this expression, you see we are using the property in the reverse fashion. We are coming from the Z transform direction, that if we take derivative of this particular expression, then this log will be vanished. And if this log is vanished, then we may be able to do something. So at the first step, we take derivative of this x of z to result in what thing? It will be 1 over 1 plus a z inverse along the derivative of a z inverse, and that is equal to minus a z raised to power minus 2. So that is on the derivative. At the second step, we multiply it with minus c. When we multiply it with minus c, it will become a z raised to power minus 2 divided by 1 plus a z inverse. And this z will reduce the power, so it will become z raised to power minus 1. Now you see, we ended up in a more familiar expression. So if you only consider again this part, so the inverse transform of this portion is directly anun. Inverse transform is anun. And what is the consequence of this z raised to power minus 1? You must invoke now the time shifting property. If you multiply it with z raised to power minus 1, the corresponding time domain sequence will be delayed. And what is the effect of this a? It is simply a constant. So by combining all these three facts, I may be able to write the final expression of x of n as a as constant separately and introducing a delay in this one and at the same time here. So simply you can say you have just used this property, but the consequence of this taking the derivative, it will be the introduction of additional n, right? So overall, this will be the formulation of the inverse Z transform. So all of this n is basically due to the property. Okay, so we move to the next properties. Next we have time reversal. Time reversal means that if you if you apply the time reversal property in time domain, what will happen in frequency domain? In frequency domain, all the poles and zeros are inverted. Means it will simply mean that if a pole is located at 2, it will go to 1 by 2. Right? So simply inversion. And definitely when you reverse a time domain sequence, so originally if it was a right sided sequence, then after reversal it will become a left sided sequence. So the consequence is that if the sequence was causal before reversal, it will not remain causal after reversal, which will result in the inversion of ROC. So you see the ROC is now equal to 1 over Rx. The ROC will also be inverted. So this is the consequence of this time reversal property. It's very simple to understand. The next one is convolution of sequences. This is very, very important property. Convolution of sequences means that if you have two time domain sequences and you convolve x1 and x2 in time domain, it is similar to performing multiplication in frequency domain. And what is the ROC? ROC will contain the intersection of both the original ROCs of X1 and X2, right? For example, if you have two sequences, let's say X1 of N, if you have X1 of N as ANUN, let us take a particular value. For example, it is 1/2 NUN, and the other one is simply, let's say, U of N. And we assume here that both are right-sided sequences. So their corresponding Z transform will be directly can be obtained for Z transform pairs. I can write it as 1/1 1-2 Z inverse. And for the second one, it is straight away equal to 1/1 Z inverse. Now, if I convolve X1 of N and X2 of N, the property says that it is simply equal to, if I take Z transform inverse of X1 of Z, rather I can place an equal sign over here because I am taking inverse Z transform, X1 of Z multiplied by X2 of Z. So just I take the Z transform, multiply them together, and after multiplication I can simply take the inverse Z transform, right? So here, let's say I name another variable Y of Z, which is equal to which is basically the product of these two, X1 of Z into X2 of Z. So it will become 1/1 1/2 Z inverse multiplied by 1/1 Z inverse. Now, to take inverse Z transform, a more convenient method is to apply partial fraction. And when we apply partial fraction, I am directly writing the answer, because in the previous lectures I have explained in detail the method of partial fraction. So you can just go and check the previous lecture as well. It will result in this one. It is 2/1 1-Z inverse minus 1/1 1/2 Z inverse. After partial fraction, I can get this expression, and finally Y of N will be equal to 2. Here it will become U of N, and it will become minus 1/2 N U of N. So instead of convolving these two sequences in time domain, it will cause cost a lot of time and computation as well. Instead, we just take Z transform and then multiply them together and apply inverse Z transform to get the final sequence. Okay, and the last property for in this context is initial value theorem, which says that if x of n is 0 for n less than 0, that is if x of n is causal, then you have x of 0 is equal to limit z approaches to infinity x of z. So you, if you put z approaches to infinity in x of z, you will end up obtaining x of 0. This is the initial value theorem. Lastly, in this lecture, I will show some significance very briefly about z transform in the context of LTI systems. So if you have any LTI system like this, you have x of n, you have a system LTI with impulse response h of n and the output as y of n. So you must know that the output can be written as the convolution of the input and the impulse response. Now, using this property, which is just discussed before some time, the convolution property, I can also write it as z inverse of x of z into h of z, or I can also write it as y of z is equal to x of z into h of z. And here I can obtain h of z, which is equal to y of z divided by x of z. So what does that it mean? It is similar to the frequency response which was discussed in DTFT context in discrete time Fourier transform. It is called frequency response. Here we say it as transfer function or we also say it as system function. So whenever you talk about transfer function or system function, it is simply the ratio of the Z transform of output and input, right? It is simply the transformation, and you can always obtain like this. And this system function is actually what? It is basically Z transform of the impulse response. So if you have got the impulse response and you are going to obtain the system function, you just take the Z transform of this impulse response. Or if you have Z transform of inputs and outputs, you can simply divide them together to get the final transfer function. Now, how to obtain this transfer function? I have just told you two methods. If you have the Z transform of input and output, you go and divide them to get transfer function. If you have impulse response, you take directly the Z transform of the impulse response. But the third method is also when you have a difference equation. For example, if you have a difference equation like this, y of n minus y of n minus 1 equals x of n plus x of n minus 1. And you have to find out the system function h of z. So one simple method is just to apply Z transform on the overall difference equation, right side and left side. So you will have here y of z minus here what? Y of z. And because of this time delay, you will have z raised to power minus 1 according to the time shifting property. And on the right side, the same phenomena, here x of z, and due to the delay, you will have z minus 1. Now if you take y of z as common, it is 1 minus z inverse. Here it is x of z, and it will result as 1 plus z inverse. And now if you rearrange the terms like this, this ratio, we have named this ratio as h of z, and it will become 1 plus z inverse divided by 1 minus z inverse. So this is the final transfer function that you have simply obtained through z transform. So you see, this is the power of z transform. You can simply apply z transform to any difference equation to find out the transfer function. And the next problem is to find out the impulse response, h of n. So you can simply apply the partial fraction or by definition method. For example, let us solve this one. I can simply rewrite the same h of z as 1 over 1 minus z inverse plus z inverse divided by 1 minus z inverse. I've just split them apart. No need to apply partial fraction. So you see, you have to decide that which problem or which example or which z transform can be solved by which method. We have inspection, we have partial fraction, or you can simply split them apart. Now just you see, I have split them apart, and now I can directly apply the inspection method along with z transform properties. So the first one will become what? It will simply become u of n, plus the second one is u of n delayed by this z raised to power minus 1, which means it is simply u of n minus 1. So that is the final Z. Finally, this is the impulse response. So you see, this is the significance and power of Z transform, that through this method you can also find out transfer function, you can find impulse response through any method, either it is difference equation or through the Z transform of the inputs and outputs. So that's all about these properties and Z transform. Thank you.